Hey guys, really, really fun comments so far. This, and I didn't know this story. Some of you know, some of you don't know. This was Jimmy Page's favorite guitar solo. There's a really great interview on iHeartRadio. It's a YouTube video where the interviewer knows that this is Jimmy's favorite solo. So he starts him on a song by Howlin' Wolf and he says, "How do you like this solo?" And Jimmy says, "It's a 10 out of 10. And then he plays him a Led Zeppelin solo, one of his solos, and he laughs and he says, "That's an 11. And he knows what's coming. He plays him Reelin' in the Years, and Jimmy says, "Well, that's a 12 out of 10. So it's really true. This is Jimmy Page's favorite guitar solo, and it's played by Elliot Randall. And Elliot was really smart. He did demos for Steely Dan in New York City. And the Dan were in L.A. at the Village camped out. They were working on this song, and they had some guitar players try it, but they couldn't get what they needed at the front. And Elliot was really smart. He played the vocal melody at the front. And then he jumped into improvising. Not only did he improvise, he played a first take that everybody flipped over. And they said, "Yeah, we got it." And then the engineer said, "Oh, I didn't record it. It was a rehearsal, I thought." So he did it again, and that's the solo you hear. So this was one take. It was the second time through. Nobody really knows if it was better than the first take, but it is an amazing take, and you can tell how spontaneous it is. And you can tell he's living on the edge through a lot of it. It's really pretty brilliant. I'd like to go through it, and then we'll talk more about the session. So he does the melody at the front. And then some blues with string skipping, and then he comes up here, repeats that phrase, and it's the third of G, so it's pretty melodic, right? And then double stops, and then walking up A major pentatonic. Those are G shapes, and then he comes up here and he plays this D, and I love that because it's D over G, right? And then single string playing, G shape. That one's kind of hard to do. And then this. And then I hear the rhythm guitars playing in the chorus with an A on top of this. So the way I play it, and then I walk up, so I get that high A ringing in there. And that might be Denny Diaz. The guitar harmonies that we're going to look at later are Jeff Baxter. And that, so says Elliot Randall on that. So the chords, you have B minor, D, A over C sharp, B minor again, and it walks down. And the second part of the chorus is really cool. E minor 7, E flat diminished, D minor, A over C sharp, and it's so cool. And that's this part. So the session, he shows up, and Elliot was kind of ahead of his time. He still has this guitar, and he still calls it his number one guitar. It's a 60s Strat that he put a humbucker in the neck position on. And we used to do that. I came along a little later than he did, but guitars were never precious, no matter how old they were. So he took a vintage Strat, and he cut a big hole in it, and he put the humbucker in. Well, this is still his favorite guitar. So he's kind of ahead of his time that way. Now, the amazing thing about this, and I read this from Elliot, so I think he would know, because he did it. He walked in, he plugged into an Ampeg SVT bass amp with 810s. And they mic'd it with an AKG 414. This is a very unusual thing. I'm thinking it was the only amp that was there, maybe. You know, I'm wondering why it was that amp. And that's what I'm thinking. You know, maybe they had a little Fender, or maybe there was a couple of amps, and that's the amp that sounded the best. A 10-inch speaker, you can tell it's kind of this edgy, bright sound. So maybe that's what happened. So it was one take. I also want to look at a little more of the song. I want to show you this harmony that Jeff Baxter played. Let's check it out. Oh, and there's a special offer on the Masterclass, guys. You can take the free trial, it's 14 days, and see if you like it. Just click the link below if you want to check out some guitar lessons in the Masterclass. Are you reeling in the years? Stowing away the time. so cool to me. And it's kind of a challenge at the end because the string actually slips off the fretboard when you go. So the way I deal with that is I lighten up so I'm not picking too hard and I come way back by the bridge. And you can kind of hear that on the record. So that's how I do that. But it's a really, really inventive harmony. And I have a funny feeling maybe Fagan and Becker came up with that. Maybe Becker did. He comes up with some pretty amazing guitar parts. And then we'll say that Skunk Baxter executed it. So now I made a little jam track that's a little more mellow, and it's got some different inversions to play along with because I'd like to do my own thing. So let's do that, and then we'll jump into some questions. If you got any questions. So A major pentatonic works so well here. And it keeps you kind of playing tasteful. You can also play the blues. As long as you end on the right note. I have a great story. One time on one of their tours, a number of years ago, they decided to do an album each night here at the Universal Amphitheater. So all of their records in a row, one record each night, and I chose Royal Scam. So we go to the show, I had no expectations, and out walks Larry Carlton, and he played the entire show as the lead guitar player in Steely Dan, doing the entire record. Royal Scam. Kid Charlemagne, Don't Take Me Alive, Larry Carlton. I actually cried a couple of times because it was so powerful. And I go see Larry Carlton when he comes to town. I saw him at the Baked Potato last time he was here. He is still great. And I actually talked to him. I met him and really good guy. And his heart and soul, it's just this, his taste. And that night when he played that with Steely Dan, he kept everybody tasteful. It's like there was a taste meter on all the musicians and they were all doing their best because he was the leader. He was the band leader. Hey, thanks. I'm glad. Oh, and yeah, I'm using different drives for this. I'm using the Shanks ODS-1 for this. But then if I step on the microamp, which is a much, much more affordable pedal, it's good too. And if I push the microamp, so, you know, it's just one knob and one switch, I can kind of get where the Shanks is. So let me try a little short pass with the microamp, and then I'll do some other questions. Once again, there's a link for a special offer on the Masterclass and the free trial. Okay, keep going. I was okay with that one. Yeah, so I just tried to not make a mistake, and I tried to pay attention to the chords and take a couple of risks, and that's how you do it, you know? But it is a totally different style. I mean, that's the thing. Every guitar player has their own totally, totally different style. Yeah, so I'll play another minute. Check out the special offer in the Masterclass if you get a chance. There's a 2-week free trial, and we have a brand new beginner's course that's over 100 videos. So all of you guys who are total beginners, there's a place you can go and learn even where to put your fingers and their first chords and everything. Thank you. taking a little more mellow approach, and I kind of designed these chords to be a little more mellow. I took the track from the record and did my own chords over it. It's more like the chorus. I have a little bit of reverb, and I have two delays on. I have one short slap delay, and then I have one longer delay. I'll show you. Here's the short and long. The short one. You hear the little slap, and then there's a long one too. And they're both in my DAW, so I can turn them up and down and change them later. And then just a little bit of reverb. But all of these, I like to use effects that you don't necessarily hear when you're playing in the track. The idea is that these delays, you hear them there, but when I play in the track, they disappear. They just blend in. And that, to me, is the best way to use them. I don't want to hear beow, beow, beow when I'm playing a lead. I just want it to help the guitar have spaciousness and help it float. Check it out. Let's see if it works. Now, this is a great question, Sam. On balance, was this solo take improvised or mostly planned in advance? I can guarantee you it was not planned at all. It was completely improvised. That's what these guys do. That's what the great players do. They walk in. They may formulate something as they listen to the song, and in his case, he formulated, I'm going to play the melody of the chorus at the front. But it was totally improvised. And you can do it. I mean, you just take your vocabulary, and you keep mixing it up. You know, even if your vocabulary is simple, like pentatonics. The video I released last Saturday is a beginner video, and I talk about how you can create a pentatonic solo very quickly and easily. That's just the five-note A major pentatonic scale. Yeah, Sam, great question. Yeah, Do It Again is one of my favorites, too. Going to that F sharp minor. Yeah, Colin, Satch uses dual delays as well. Yeah, I love it. I love the delays that are panned hard left and right, a little bit of modulation, the top end turned down. Now, these are the keys, and I'm not alone in this. If you take the delay sound and you turn down the treble, it gets darker, and it stays out of the way of the original signal. And also, if you modulate it a little bit, it creates this wonderful rub. This little bit of very subtle chorusing that's side to side, but it stays out of the way of the middle. So yeah, anytime you get a chance to use a stereo delay, you should take it because it's just wonderful, for soloing especially, yeah? It's really traveling all over the neck. Thank you so much for joining us. We'll see you on the next one. And yeah, it's I understand why Jimmy Page called this solo a 12 out of 10. Now, there's a lot to it. There's a lot more to it if you guys want to learn more. It's also, there's a lot of great films. One thing that he did is he did octaves on this. on a live performance. And I thought that was really, really cool. And it's the kind of octave you have to grab here, and you have to mute the two strings in between. Anyway, guys, this was great. Hey, Keith, you guys are about to do a live stream. Check out Beato's live stream with Keith today, Keith Williams. Thanks for joining. I'm about to wrap it up, and we'll hand it off to all the other YouTubers out there. You guys have a great weekend, and we'll see you on the next one. Let me play us out.